What do you think the potential is for any human being to live the life they want? What would you say? Okay, some two people said unlimited, everybody else is quiet. How many would agree it's really unlimited? Potential, at least. If you do, give me a yes.
Yeah.
So if our potential's unlimited, the question is, do most people's results in life reflect their true potential? Would you say yes or no?
No.
Absolutely not. Why not? You tell me. Well, a lot of people say because they don't take action. I kind of led you with this, right?
Yes.
But you could be a salesman and you can knock on 100 doors and say, you don't want to buy anything from me, would you? You may not say that verbally, but your fear, your emotion could do that. Somebody's going to buy from you out of pity. So a lot of action's helpful, but if you're not certain it's going to work, you won't execute. That's when people say, I tried that. And whenever you say, I've tried that, I know they didn't do the right thing. So I created this graphic, and you might want to jot it down, those of you at home or yourself, these four words: potential, action, results, and then belief or certainty. And here's how they work in a circle. Our potential is amazing, but if you don't believe something's going to work, if you've tried to lose weight before and you tried a diet and it didn't work out well, you don't feel certain anymore, and you're also fearful of failing. So when you're uncertain, do you tap full potential, yes or no? No, and when you don't think it's going to work, you not only don't take full potential, but are you going to take massive action when you think it's not going to work anyway? So when you use little potential with little action, what kind of results are you going to get? Lousy results. When you get lousy results, what does it do to your belief? Your brain goes, see, I told you it wouldn't work. See, I told you nothing never happened. See? And then what happens? Less potentials tap, less action, worse results, and now you're on the downward spiral. Who's ever been there in a relationship or with your body, your finances, you know what I mean? Yeah. Now, you might be doing well in one area, like with your kids. You got great movement, but maybe on your finances, not so good. So sometimes we're going in different directions. So how would you change this? What would you guys do? Someone yell it out. What would you do to change the momentum? Where would you enter? Would you work on your potential? That's right. You got a belief. So how do you change your belief? The way you do it with athletes, because I worked with like the Warriors last year, I worked with the NHL champion Stanley Cup, Washington Capitals. You get results in advance. They visualize it, as simple as that sounds, but I'm gonna show you. Can we pop over
here? Please, yeah.
Would you all stand up and I'll show you a quick technique.
Oh, we get a technique. We have to learn this right now. Yeah, come on over here.
Put your, over here?
Yeah.
Put your feet together straight ahead and then bring your right index forward straight in front of you. And when I say now, I want you to turn clockwise comfortably just as far as you naturally turn, okay? Keep your feet straight, go. Turn clockwise naturally. Everyone at home can do it too. Keep your feet straight. See where you end up? Come back around. Take your finger out of your neighbor's ear. Okay, now close your eyes. It's so simple. Even if you don't think you visualize, you can feel. So I want you to imagine your finger coming up, and imagine it so vividly it feels like it's coming up. Don't actually do it if you're at home or here, but imagine the finger comes up, and then imagine yourself turning twice as far, and it feels really good. See it, feel it. Open your eyes. Now, bring your finger straight, and now turn as far as you can comfortably and see where you go this time.
Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness.
Okay. So here's my question. Here's my question. How many of you went significantly further? How many went at least 25% further this time? Okay, go. So here's my quick question. Did you have the potential to turn that far the first time? The potential.
Potential, yes.
Yes. So why didn't you? Because you have beliefs even about how far you can turn, even though you're unaware of them. So you have beliefs about money, you have beliefs about relationship, you have beliefs about business, you have beliefs about your own beauty or strength. And so the way to change them, this is the simplest way I could show you in 2 minutes, is to condition your mind. Because once the mind is certain, the body will go there. Or once the mind is certain, the emotions will go there. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
What is this really about? Ultimately, if you're going to have lasting change in anything, you're really talking about just raising your standards. I mean, I always tell people, if you want to know how to change your life, I give it to you in 3 words, boring as it sounds: raise your standards. And what does that mean? Corny as it sounds, raise your standards. Oh, thank you for the breakthrough thought, Tony. I'm glad I wasted my time watching this little email with you. But think about it. Lasting change is different than a goal. You don't always get your goals, but you always get your standards. Maybe it'll help you is to think about it this way. I try to explain standards to people with a different set of words. Think of it as everybody in life gets their musts. They don't get their shoulds. Like, think about it. Most people have a list of shoulds, don't they? Don't you have a list of the shoulds, things you should do, you should follow through on? I should lose some weight. I should work out more. I should make more calls. I should respond more rapidly to my email. Whatever, you know? I should get into the office earlier. I should be, you know, more confident. Whatever your should list is, people love to have their should list be met, but it's kind of like New Year's resolutions. If it does, it's really exciting, but if it doesn't, which is most of the time, it's a little disappointing, but you kind of know it's not going to happen. But when you decide something is a must for you, an absolute must, when you cut off any possible, you say, I'm going to find the way or I'm going to make the way. Human beings, when they resolve things, when they make a real resolution inside themselves, which is they raise the standard and they make it a must, they find the way. Think about it in your own life. Haven't you had some area of your life where you raise your standard and your life has never been the same? Maybe at one time in your life you smoked cigarettes, or you did something and you did it for years and you kept trying to change it and kept telling yourself I should. And then one day something happened. Something just clicked you over. Something took you over that kind of tipping point. And inside yourself you said no more. And it was a very, very different experience, wasn't it? Something inside of you shifted, and what was a should became a must, and you've never gone back. Is there an area like that in your life you can think of? Again, did you ever smoke cigarettes? Did you ever eat a certain way, drink a certain form of alcohol, and then finally say no more, and you just don't go back? And notice this, it doesn't really take any willpower anymore. Because somewhere when we make this click, when we make something a must, we attach ourselves to it. It becomes part of our identity. And one thing I've learned in the last, 33 years of working with people from now over 100 countries, 4 million people, is human beings absolutely follow through on who they believe they are. If you said to me, well, I'm really going to work hard to stop smoking, but, you know, I've been a smoker my whole life, and I'm, you know, I am a smoker. I know your days are numbered. You're going to be back smoking cigarettes again, because we all act consistent with who we believe we are. I tell people the strongest force in the whole human personality is this need to stay consistent with how we define ourselves. If you define yourself as somebody who is really conservative, you're not going to be crazy and act nuts unless you're really drunk or something, and then you can say it's the alcohol, when it's really just you finally getting permission to be yourself. The alcohol is your excuse. If you're a really crazy person, you act crazy, outrageous, playful. You don't act conservative because that's not who you are. Very often people say, well, I can't do that. I'm not that kind of person. And I always say to people, really, when did you define yourself? I mean, really, how many years ago did you come up with what you could and couldn't do in your life? How many years ago? Most people, if they really look at how they're living their life today, it's based on a set of standards, a set of beliefs that they made choices about 10, 20, 30 or more years ago. I mean, very often we made decisions in our youth or very young about what to believe, about what we were capable of, about who we are as a person, and that becomes the glass ceiling, if you will, that controls us. There's a corny metaphor, but it's true. I remember one time I was with my family at the circus, and there was a person there, and they had this big, giant elephant, and you look at this elephant, and they take this little rope, put it around the elephant's neck, and they drive this stake into the ground. And I mean, you look at this and you know that elephant could rip down the entire tent with almost no effort. And yet the elephant doesn't struggle, doesn't try. Why? Because the elephant's conditioned. And they take that elephant and condition the elephant when it's a baby elephant. That's how they train them. When it's a little baby elephant and it doesn't have the power yet, they put a big rope around it and they drive this huge stake in the ground, and the elephant fights and fights and fights. And one day, finally, that elephant decides, I'm not capable of pulling this out. And once that becomes the definition of an identity of anyone, an elephant in this case, they don't even try anymore. It's just who I am. That's how it is. That's just the way it is in my life. I'd like to ask you to take a look at any place you've got a limitation and ask yourself, when did I decide to accept that limitation? And you may not even see it as a limitation. You might see it as just that's who I am. But so often in our lives, we've adapted to be a certain way so that we don't fail or so that people will like us or respect us, but it's not necessarily who we are. Joy comes when you're spontaneous. It's really hard to be truly happy when you're not being yourself. And most of us have no clue who we are. And so a big part of my work, if you've ever been to an event, you know, is to get people to do things spontaneously without thinking, because that's when the real you shows up. That's when the energy comes alive. And when you do that, when you start to connect to your true nature, suddenly there's energy available for you to set a higher standard for what you want in your life. That's what this is really all about. And when I talk about standards, when I talk about, you know, shoulds versus musts, think about your own life. I know there have been areas in your life where some point in time you just shifted and you raised the standard and your life changed. Because whatever people have their identity attached to, they live. We live who we believe we are. That's just how it works. It's just kind of like, I'll give you an example. Look at your physical body. Your physical body today is an absolute reflection of only one thing. Not your goals, not your desires, but your standards.
the identity you have for yourself. If your standard is you're an athlete, then there's a certain amount of strength, a muscle tone, and energy that's available in your body on a regular basis because that's who you are. And so you do whatever's necessary to maintain that identity. Again, the strongest force in the human personality is this need to stay consistent with how we define ourselves. Because if you don't know who you are, you wouldn't know how to act. Once you lock in on that identity, your brain finds a way to keep you there. If you say, I'm overweight, I've always been overweight, I'm big boned, and that's the story you've got, then you're going to always find a way to get back there. That's your settling point. That's your identity. That's where things lock in. If you see somebody who's in really great shape, you ask them, do you work out? You know the answer. Yes. How often? And they'll tell you 3 times, 4 times, 5 times a week, whatever. In a seminar, I'll ask people, who here works out at least 5 days a week? And I'm stand up. And you look around that room, and you know that they work out 5 times a week because you can see their body. You don't just get a result without some kind of action, without some form of ritual. Ritual meaning actions you do consistently. Now, do you think those people that are out there working out 5 days a week, do they have more time than you do? Or I have, or anybody else? Of course not. Is their life less busy? Of course not. It's just a must for them. They must work out that way, and they've made that turn and their life changed. So I'm not saying you have to work out 5 days a week. I'm just saying whatever you really want, wants don't get met consistently. Standards do. Whatever you identify, this is who I am. And so it's not so much about changing your identity as it is expanding it. You know, deciding that, you know, instead of your goals to lose 10 pounds, which is not compelling, what if your vision was to get back to my fighting weight? You know, this year, this month, this next 90 days, I'm going to transform my body. I'm going to take on a new challenge. I'm going to find some technique or strategy. There's a million of them that can reframe myself where I want to feel younger, stronger, more vibrant than ever before. Here's my reasons. Because I want the energy to really make my life work. Because it's tough out there and I want to be stronger than I've ever been before. I want to go in front of the mirror and if I'm naked, not, you know, want to laugh. I want to look there and take a good look and go, yeah, I'm proud of whatever I see there. Whatever it takes, something's going to make you laugh, smile, something's going to tease yourself, but something's going to move you to another level. If you identify yourself in a new way and you own that every day and that becomes the standard of how you live, you'll find the way to make that standard real. Money's the same way. Think about it. It doesn't matter what's happening, quote unquote, in the marketplace. People that make money find a way to make money no matter what, don't they? I mean, most people's standard is to pay their bills. So that's what most people find a way to do, even when economic times get tough. Most people, if that's their absolute standard, they find a way. Some people's standard is pay their bills most of the time. And so most of the time they do. Some people's standard is not just to pay their bills, but to take care of their family and maybe even some of their friends. And they find a way. In fact, you know, some people may be in a family where they don't have enough money. They barely have money to pay their bills. They work their guts out. And then somebody, their mother, their father, somebody else, their sister gets ill, and there's not enough money to take care of it. Nobody else has money in the family. They don't either, but they find a way to get that money to take care of their mother or father, don't they? And pay their bills. They never could do it before. Why? The situation made them raise their own standard. And not everybody does that. Somebody else in the family might have money and still not take care of their mother. It all comes down to the inner game, my friends. Changing your life is a change in the inner game. The outside world you can't control, but you have absolute control over this one if you learn the dynamics of what shapes you. And identity is one of those simple, clear, fundamental basics that if you start to shift it, everything else will shift in your life. There's an interesting guy named Mel Fisher that you may remember from back in the 90s. He was, if the name lingers in your mind, he was a guy that spent, I think it was 27 years, if I remember correctly, looking for this Spanish galleon that was supposed to be filled with gold. Do you remember that?
Of course.
And he had found it after 27 years. Now, here's my question for you, Jim.
Yeah.
5 years into it, you've worked every day for 5 years, and you found nothing. What are you going to do? And how are you going to raise more money? Because you have run out of money. 10 years into it, 15 years into it, 20 years into it. So I say to people in business, I say to them, you want to understand psychology? Here's the biggest challenge for most businesses. They think they've maxed what's possible because they think they've tried everything. Once you believe that, your belief controls you and you miss the innovations, you miss the answers. This guy found that gold because he had three beliefs. First belief was there's a treasure out there, and he was certain it was out there, even though he didn't have any absolute evidence. And that certainty drove him. But if you knew there was treasure in your business, that's not enough. You got to also believe, I will find it.
And he also had to believe it's worth it, mm-hmm. right? And without those three beliefs, he never would have found it. And so changing the psychology of the leader is what will change a business faster than anything else. Changing their skills will also do it. But lots of people have the skill and they don't execute. And you and I both know, you know, execution's more important than knowledge. Knowledge is trumped by execution every single day. And that execution comes by changing the psychology. There was a day that I became wealthy. I'll tell you the day, I know that day I was rich. I was broke. I was pissed. I was angry at everybody else but who? Myself. But really underneath it, I was mad at myself. I just couldn't beat myself up anymore, so I was pissed. And I had a friend that I loaned money to when I had barely enough, and I knew he needed it, and I gave him $1,200, and I'm here not able to eat. I'm down to like $25, $26, and I'm saying to him, calling him, and he's not returning my call, and I just need some money, and he's ignoring me. I didn't ignore him then, so I'm pissed. I'm frustrated. In the midst of all this, I'm also pragmatic. I got 25 and change, call it $26. What the hell am I gonna do? I don't have any plans for economics. I got overhead that's crazy. I'm living in this little tiny apartment, 400 square feet in Venice, California. So I thought, okay, when I was totally broke early on, when I was 17, I used to save my money up and go to the smorgasbord and load up for Christmas, you know, load up for the week. So I said, I was in Venice, I'm gonna go over to Marina Del Rey, where all the yachts are, and there's a place there called El Torito, and I'm gonna go, they have an all-you-can-eat smorgasbord, I'm gonna load up for the winter. I'm gonna get there. So I didn't drive there, because I wasn't gonna spend the gas to get there, plus I needed to walk, so I walked there. And I go in, I'm not dressed really great, but it's Marina Del Rey, it's okay, and I got a place right by the window, and I can see these yachts going by, and I'm dreaming of what life could be like. And I'm starting to let go of my anger, and I'm starting to start focus on what I want instead of what I don't want. How many followers say I? And that shifted me just a bit. And now I'm eating, which shifted me a lot. And I got this giant plate stacked up. And I don't know what the amount was. It was like, whatever it was, $6.95, $7.95, right? So I'm going to do this. I could probably do this three or four times, right? Somewhere in that range. As I'm finishing my meal, this little boy comes in, dressed in a little suit. And I honestly don't know how old he'd be, probably in the third grade, so maybe 8 years old, 9 years old, something like that. And he was so adorable, and he opened the door for his mother, and his mother was an attractive lady, and he came over and he pulled out the seat for her, and she sat down. And she was a pretty lady, but as pretty as she was, I was totally obsessed by this boy. He was just, he had presence at 7 or 8 years old. And it moved me. I don't know why, it moved me. And I thought, this kid is like pure. I want him to always be this way. He's such a good kid. He's a giver. So I got up and I paid for the meal and whatever it was, $6-$7. So now I've got whatever left, $17, $18, $19. And I walk up to this little boy and I said, excuse me. And I said, I just want to acknowledge you for being such an extraordinary gentleman. I said, I saw the way you treated your lady, how you opened the door, how you pulled the chair out. I said, that's class. I said, my name's Tony, what's yours? I don't honestly remember his name, Charlie or something. And he looked up at me and I said, Charlie? I said, that's amazing, taking your date out for a lunch like this. He goes, well, actually, she's my mom. And I said, that's even more cool. And he said, oh, but I'm not taking her lunch because I'm just, I think he said he was 8. I said, oh, yes, you are. And I had no plan for this. I just reached in my pocket, I took all the money I had left, $17, $18, $19, and I put it on the table. I said, you're taking her to lunch. He looked up at me and he goes, I can't take that. I said, sure you can. He said, why? Because I'm bigger than you are. And he smiled real big, and I didn't even look at his mom. I just turned and walked away. And I didn't walk out of that door. I flew home. I should have been freaking out. How the fuck am I gonna eat? But I didn't. I flew because something inside of me had finally got past scarcity, had finally realized there's something inside of us more than our limits, especially around this thing called money that I had let terrorize me. And I got home, and the mailman came that day, and I had no idea I was going to have my next meal. And a letter comes, and it's from the guy I loaned the money to. Handwritten notes saying, I've been avoiding you. It's wrong. I'm so sorry. You were there when I needed you. Here's what I owe you plus a little bit more. And the $1,200 was there plus another $100
for the time that I had to take care of it. And for me, $1,300, that was enough to like run my show for a month or two. And I cried. And then I decided, what does this mean? And I thought, this means that whenever you give, it's always gonna come back, so you don't have to ever think about that shit again. Just give. And the rewards will be greater than you can ever imagine. I don't know if that's coincidence, but I decided to believe that day was a blessing when I became rich. And I can tell you honestly, I've had tough days in my life, economically, emotionally, like all of us. But I've never gone back to that scarcity. I never will. The secret to living is giving. Do it when you don't have it, and I promise you, scarcity will leave your life. One of the most important ones was early in my life. One of my mentors, a man named Jim Rohn, said, Tony, all you have to focus on in your life is find a way to add more value than anybody else does, and you'll never have to worry about anything. Be the person that does more for others, and life will just be anything you want out of it, really is what it is. And he also said the way to do that is every day work harder on yourself than anything else. Because if you become more intelligent, more valuable, more skilled, you can add more value to other people.